everybody. Happy Sabbath, everybody.
Happy Sabbath.
Okay, today's story is one you may have heard of. Has anybody ever heard of Jesus walking on the water? I know you've heard about it. Yes, most of you have heard it. So I'm going to tell you about it. And I'm not going to read from the Bible, but I'll give you the verses of the Bible so that when we go home, we can share it with our parents and even uncles, grandmas, and we can always have something to learn from it. So this story is about Jesus and one of his 12 disciples called Peter. Can everybody say Peter?
Peter.
Okay. So what happened was he was preaching, and during the day he had performed a miracle where he has fed very many people, and everybody was following him and was excited, and they wanted him to be their leader, and he didn't want that. What he wanted was to teach them about the goodness of God and how mighty God was. So when the night, as approached the evening, what happened was he told his disciples, hey, I want you guys to go across this lake, or you can call it a river, and we'll see, I'll meet you there. But he was left behind. Do you know what happened? I have questions for you guys, so just give me a minute. So what happened was, he was left in the mountain praying. So the disciples got into a boat and started rowing throughout the night. And just before dawn broke, you know, like right at the edge of the water where you start seeing the light starting to come up, they saw Jesus walking on the water. And they're like, hey, that looks like a ghost. And they weren't sure. Then Peter, who was brave enough, said, hey, if Jesus, if that's you, let me walk on the water just like you. And he said, hey, come over. And can you imagine walking on water? So he got up and got onto that water and started walking. But he felt the wind blowing, and he was like, hey, you know, if the wind is blowing, and so he stopped looking at Jesus. What if he started thinking about, what happened? What did he think?
He was so afraid and he was about to sink.
That's true. And he started getting into the water. And what do you think happened after that? I want to know. Let's get somebody else. Maya, are you happy? Hand up. You know what happened after that?
Yeah.
That's right. So what happened was Jesus told him, he grabbed his hand and he took him up. And the reason why he was sinking is because he had let his mind stray away from the what? The Lord. So in this story, we see that there's nothing impossible. That's what we need to learn about it. There's nothing impossible that our God cannot do. Okay, so I want you to do me a favor. When you go home, have where give each child a piece of paper, and you're going to color it, and the verses of the Bible from where this story comes from is in that piece of paper, and we could share it with also our Christian friends to know that Jesus is always there. When everything seems impossible, God makes everything possible for us. So who's going to pray for us? I want somebody who hasn't talked this morning. Aaron, who's talked this morning. I need somebody else to pray for us. Somebody. Nobody wants to pray today? Daniel, you want to pray?
Thank you, Jesus. go back to our parents and sing quietly.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
Time for our tithes and offerings. This offering today is for the world budget. Special emphasis on world administration. I trust everyone this week has gained a new appreciation of electricity and hot water. Just thought I'd throw that out there. We also need to remember that there are plenty of places around the world that still do not have access to all the things we take for granted here. But World Adventist Radio can still reach them. We want to make sure that this mission is supported as well. So wherever the Holy Spirit impresses you to give, please put some money into the offering for that. If you want to designate a chair for that, this is the week to do it. If you want to continue to do it later, write it on the envelope. But that is where it is going. Let us bow our heads as we pray for the offering tithes. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the many blessings that you continue to give us, Lord. We know this week we certainly have been blessed. We ask that you be with all those who have suffered from this recent incident of weather. We thank you so much that we are here and that we are able to worship you, that we are able to bring our tithes and our offerings into your storehouse. Lord, we ask you to help us to remember that we need to be good stewards with the money and the time that you have given us. Please take these tithes and offerings, bless them and multiply them in accordance with you. And bring joy to our hearts and bring help these tithes and offerings bring love to those who can benefit from us. And help us to spread your word and hasten that day when you will come again. We ask this in your name. Amen. Let's go forward.
I'm going to read it, and it begins like this. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. And the Lord has blessed the reading of his word today. I'm going to begin with the word of prayer as we start our sermon. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing us here yet again. Lord, I pray that you speak through me today as we open your word and have a conversation about who you are and how we can see you best. Allow someone to gain a little bit more insight about the glory that you are and how to love you and receive your love. All these things you pray in your name. April of 1990, the American Space Shuttle Discovery launched up from the Earth a very special payload. It was this, the Hubble Space Telescope. Above the thinnest parts of the atmosphere, the Hubble will be able to see off into the distance the stars and the galaxies without any distortion, and expand our understanding of the universe. Well, at least that was the plan. By June, it was clear that there was something very wrong. The telescope, with one of the most perfectly round mirrors, you can see it right there. It's this huge mirror that would help to help focus the images off into the distant space. And it turns out that even though this is a brand new telescope, it was still a little bit short-sighted. This is an 8-foot-2-inch mirror. It took them 2 years to make this. 2 years. Now, it was rendered incapable because there was an error. And the error was less than 1/50th of the width of a human hair. So, such a big instrument, it was off by 1/50th of a fraction of a hair width. So that error prevented it from being able to focus properly. So, let's look at these images. Now, these images are interesting because The image on the left is from a telescope that was viewing these same stars from the Earth. Now, the image on the right is the new Hubble telescope that cost the American Impact Taxpayer $1.5 billion. And if you look at the image, you can barely see that it's really not much of an improvement. So this was a tremendous embarrassment to NASA because they spent all this money and people are complaining like this really is not doing much for what it is that we paid for. So what they had done is they made another mirror. They made two at the same time. But the problem was the second mirror was here on Earth, not up in space. So they had to configure another launch. and take this mirror up there. Replace the lens with a 5-man crew and recalibrate this very amazing telescope and reinstall a brand new mirror. That took them 3.5 years to get to that point where they were able to do that. But now, this is the amazing part. Once they got that recalibrated, they figured out what that very, very small error was. Let's look and see what the Hubble telescope can now get. Wow, look at that. Let's go back one. That's what they got. That was their first shot. Once they made the corrections, this is what they see. Let's see one more. Imagine, this is the first time us were able to see so far into the sky. All these amazing things that are really difficult to describe. And they're really just the dreams that we have to know what's out there. And finally, for the first time, we're able to see. So the reason is, why did I share this with you today? We have many challenges facing us as we walk and share our ideas of who God is and how He has revealed Himself to us through Scripture. Just like when we stargaze in our campsite and we're in our backyard, I know we've probably all done this, and we look up and we see all those little specks into the sky. And we just imagine like how beautiful that universe is up there. But today I want to make a suggestion to you that why don't we consider Jesus is a lens? This is kind of what I'm going with today. Jesus is a very special lens. That lens is in which we can look at God the Father for the first time and truly get a sense for who He is and what God is and how God wants us to see Him. Now, the world today, no one really ever questions, does Jesus exist? For many people say Jesus was a great man, a prophet, but there's no one that ever has denied that He has existed on this earth. But the real question is why is Jesus important for our salvation? That's really the issue. That's really the question. And this is where we lose people. It's not that Jesus exists, it's why is He important for our salvation? I want to share with you a diagram that I did about 5 years ago with a friend of mine. We were working late, we're at work in the architecture studio, and everyone's done, it's just me and him, we were trying to get a project done. And then, you know, when you're working late with a friend or a colleague, you start talking about very theoretical things. What if? You know, you talk about the world and the universe and complex issues. This young man, he was a Christian like myself. So, while we were talking about God, we were saying, man, you know that, isn't it odd how it doesn't make sense to you that God would say that the only way to get salvation is through Jesus? Like, why would He do that? Like, why does He not just make it available? You can approach God from any direction, you know? Like, why such a specific, narrow approach to seeing God, how God wants us to see Him? So we started drawing. We started diagramming, because, you know, we try to figure things out on paper and draw what that would look like. First thing we drew was a bridge, and we showed, maybe this is what God is trying to say. Everyone's over here, and to get to God, you have to cross this bridge, which might be Jesus. But then it didn't make sense to us, because not everyone is coming to God from the same perspective, certainly not from the same side of the issue. People are approaching God from so many angles. So this is a sketch that we drew. So you can see, we thought, well, What if God, this is all theoretical, this is us talking at 1 o'clock in the morning. What if God is just out in diagram grammatically? God is in space, and theoretically anyone can approach God from any direction. But what God has done, you can see in the middle, God's in the middle, but everyone's approaching from their own way. What God is saying, I want you to approach God through Jesus. And so, we start to look at this, and you know, we said, okay, all the people, the Buddhists out there, they have their own approach to God, the Hindus have their way, the Taoists have their way, Muslims have their way, pantheists have their way, Judaism, they have their own way, Islam has their way, atheists even have their way if they consider, if they are choosing to have God in their universe or not, they have to consider what God is or isn't. But the point is that everyone has their own concept of what God looks like and how to get to God or how to, in their opinion, maybe be God. So Christ is the mechanism, which is that lens that God allows us to narrow our focus. So imagine what God is asking us to do is don't just approach in any direction, but I want you to approach God in a very specific way. So everyone needs to find one from a very kind of narrow perspective to get to God. These are my sketches, but they're just my sketches. Let's look what the scripture has to say. Okay? So turn with me to Matthew 7, 13 and 14. Matthew 7, 13 and 14. You know this text. This is the one that talks about the narrow and the wide gates. And it reads, enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many may enter through it, but small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. When I read that, that kind of gives you chills. Only a few find it. These are not my words. These are words from the scripture. Also, let's look at John 10:9. I'm going to read this excerpt. It says, I am the door by me. If any man enter it, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. So when I read that, I was like, that's interesting. But you know what? Let's put it in this entire context. So open with me to John chapter 10, verses 1 through 18. I'll read the whole thing because it's just that amazing. So I'm going to read verse 1, and here it goes. Very truly, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is a shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. Verse 4, when he has brought out all of his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used his figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying. Verse 7. So again, Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep do not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. Let's continue, verse 11. I'm not done yet. It gets even better. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because the hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Verse 16. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. That's interesting. There's other people that aren't even in his corral he's talking about. There's other sheep that are not in my fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice, for there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me. He's talking about his Father. That's beautiful. Because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down for my own accord. I have power to lay it down and have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. That's so beautiful. So, you know what? When I look at my diagram I made with my friend, maybe it's not so far off. You know? Really, he's saying he is the shepherd. He is the gate. It all makes sense. And love is the key that is combining all this together. What I love about this text is that he says that he is a good shepherd. But what does that mean? It means that he is willing to lay down his life for the sheep. One cannot show more love for another. This is just between you and me, and friends, family, to one another. One cannot show more love for one another than being willing to lay down your own life. That is, in our standards, in this world we live in, that is the greatest show of love and care for somebody, is being able to lay your life down in that place. And that's what Christ is saying here in this text. Now, have you ever tried to share God, who God is with an unbeliever? Now, it's difficult. I've tried, and I've failed. It's very difficult sometimes. Sometimes you might feel like how the astronomers and scientists felt before the Hubble telescope was created. There is this amazing universe out there, but you don't have the tools and you don't know how to share it with all these people. So, how do we share who Christ is with non-believers? I have a friend, she's Japanese. We went out to dinner one time. And we started talking about our religion and our religious background. And my friend, she's a Buddhist. I don't know if she practices a lot, but that was her cultural, like, religious background. And I started to explain to her, from my perspective, how the earth began. It began through creation. And I shared my story of Adam and Eve and how a snake tempted Eve to eat a fruit, and because she ate the fruit, our world, as we know it, fell into sin. And then we became separated from God physically, and I went on and on. And as I was sharing this story of Adam and Eve, I could hear my own words as if I was hearing the concept of God for the first time. And I could see the look on her face that it wasn't making any sense. You hear the story so out of context, it didn't make any sense to her. And I was listening to it for the first time, I'm like, wow, what am I saying? This is not the right way how to approach the subject. So what did I do? I got embarrassed. I changed the subject. And I started talking about something else because I realized I didn't know what to say. You know, and I realized Christianity makes sense to Christians. So how do you share God with
other people. So, first I realized that, no, we need to share God through the logic of love. Very logical. To love and to be loved is persistent and urgent with all of our desires. We all know intuitively without anybody ever telling us that we are made for faithful, trustworthy relationships. Our hearts are fueled by a hungry yearning for connection, impersonal engagement, and a sense of belonging. As creatures of the divine image, we are engineered for giving and receiving love. That's what and who we are as humans. That's what we're meant to be. It logically follows that then God, of a self-giving God who loves us, would create others in his image and would be a communicator by nature, since communication is intrinsic to the healthy operation of love. So we'd be looking for a God that we seek to communicate to us. We would expect that God of love would naturally want to be known by those he made. That makes sense. And this is precisely what we find to be the case. That God wants to be our friend. But let's read again in Christ's words. John is full of the main text about Christ. So turn with me in John 15, 12 and 17. To see what Christ says. It reads in verse 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. Here, now Christ is saying that. What we just talked about earlier. Christ is acknowledging that no one has greater love than to lay down one's life for another friend. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because a servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. Just let that sink in for a moment. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, and fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask of in his name. I'm giving you these commands so that you will love one another. So just imagine, this is the most amazing encounter, the incredible thing you can do. The most powerful person in the universe, none other than God, doesn't want to dominate us by his power, but rather he desires to befriend us by a means of communication, by making himself known to us. And this explains why God has given us a book of words. He's given us this Bible. This is one of the most concrete ways he loves to communicate to us. So in our Bible, let's look at 2 Timothy 3:16. Well, actually, I'll just read it. You don't have to look it up. But what it says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable by doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. So the Bible here is called Scripture, which makes a bold claim that it is God's communicating device. But remember what Jesus said, friendship is the goal of his communication to us. The Bible is not intended to exert a corrosive authority over our rational process and demand blind compliance. The Bible claims rather to be the medium in which God discloses his love and opens a way up for us to know him. Regarding human words, Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks. Likewise, if the Bible is God's word, then we can expect to find it in an unfolding of God's heart. So,
not only have this conversation about what we say to a non-believer, but we just simply share the story of Christ. In that sharing, Christ's love will become real to that person. It will make sense. It will pique their curiosity. It will be a solution to loneliness, separation, all these things you feel on this earth. Christ is the solution. So share it with your friends. Share it with your family. Another amazing concept you can also read in is in John 15:16. It says that, we read it already, but it's talking about Christ chose us. Okay, so let's just remove all of our opinions to the side. We all have our own opinions. Let's put it to the side for a moment. Let's not go down that path of saying, what do I want God to be to me? Don't go that way. Okay? And try to see the big picture like we looked at the stars. You know when you look up, there is the galaxy, there's amazing things out there. You just know it, you trust it. Although you see little specks and dots, you know there's something greater there. So let's just put your opinions aside for a moment and just believe that God is. See that God is. Does that make sense? Know that God simply is. Just like we don't question what we find when we look up. If you search in your heart, just put your personal opinions to the side and just believe that God is. Try that for a moment and see where it leads you.
Money.
No, just as you look up into the sky and you see those stars, and you know in the deepest part of your soul that you're looking at like supernovas, that you're looking at planets larger than our sun, that you know that there's galaxies out there beyond comprehension, that's what we kind of saw. We know that it is because we see it. We know that God is because He is. I love how Christ describes Himself as a shepherd in John, like what we read earlier in John 10. Now, imagine this. Imagine a sheep choosing his own shepherd. That doesn't happen. The sheep would be like, I want this rock to be my shepherd. I want this other sheep to be my shepherd. You'll be pointing in every direction. Worst case scenario, you might say, I want the wolf to be my shepherd. How dangerous would that be? A couple of weeks ago, I heard a lecture from, it's a very interesting fellow, Jordan Peterson. He is a clinical psychologist, cultural critic, and professor of psychology at the University of Toronto. Now, I don't think he's a Christian, but I think he's agnostic, or maybe perhaps an atheist. But in his lecture, he deconstructed Peter Pan. Now, there's this thing called the Peter Pan syndrome, where, like Pan, one never wants to grow up. Peter's last name is intentionally significant in this children's story. It's Pan. Pan wasn't just picked randomly, but Pan has a meaning. What does Pan mean? Pan, dictionary definition, is an all-inclusive, especially in relation to the whole of a continent, a racial group, religion, etc. So we use the word Pan as a combining form in language. For instance, like Pan-African, Pan-Asian. Pan, we use, in this case, in the religious term, pantheism, which is the view that God is everything and everyone, and that everyone and everything is God. It is a worship that it admits or tolerates all gods.
Now, this next word is in our lexicon nowadays, pansexual. It's a current term used in today's society where it's not just limited in sexual choice with regard to biological sex. It doesn't matter your gender or your gender identity. You can be everything. So this word, as he was breaking down, deconstructing the story for your kid, I'll do it for you in 1 minute. Now, he's a boy that never grows up. He has some adults around him, but who are they? The most popular one is Hook, Captain Hook. But he wants to be Captain Hook. Number one, he has a hook for a hand, which is terrible. Number two, he's a tyrant, which is again terrible. Number three, he's chased by the dragon of chaos, which has a clock in his stomach, which we all know is a crocodile. And I, when I did this research, I didn't realize a crocodile had a name. And the name was TikTok, meaning a clock. Now, TikTok already had a piece of hook because he bit his hand off. Another thing about this is what happens when you get older. Time is a little piece of it. And it's trying to not just get, and once it's got a taste of you, it's going to want to try to get everything. So time, you're constantly being chased by time. Hook is so traumatized by this, he can't help but be a tyrant. So Peter Pan says, I'm not going to sacrifice my childhood for that. So he becomes Sweat, the king of the Lost Boys. His best friend is a fairy, but she's not really real. It's not really a companion for him. She's 3 inches, 4 inches. But he meets this girl named Wendy from the real world. And then is faced with this reality to keep. Then he's faced with the reality of, number one, trying to keep living his dream world with no rules, no responsibilities. Or should he consider going with Wendy to the real world? Face the reality of growing up. Face the responsibility of being an adult, perhaps raising a family, being a husband and a father, work for a living. These are his options. So Jordan Pearson, it's funny, he ends that story, and you know, at the end, he says something interesting. He said, you know what? The one thing Christians have right is they understand this concept of responsibility. They try to pick up heavy things. If life deals you a terrible hand, trust God, go forward. Don't be afraid, so you say. Yes, I'm useless as I am. I'm going to move that big stone from there all the way over there. With God's help. You're not afraid to try. And he sees there's this redeeming quality. He's not even a Christian. He says, you know what? One thing that they have right is this sense of responsibility and not being fearful. You know? Because for you and I, all in this room, we know we have God behind us that will help us through the most difficult things. We're scared. It's not easy. But we have that confidence that through God, anything's possible.
Amen.
So that's what his meaning was, is that he was saying that's a really good concept. But a man and a woman, they need to make a decision. He or she is not going to do something meaningful. Are you going to trust God and believe? Are you going to make that tough decision that Peter Pan had to make? Are you going to just do whatever the world says? Just, I'm going to be all I am God today. Or are we going to face what you might feel really in your heart, that hard decision of following that narrow path that God has laid out for us? You know what? Christ, he puts this all in perspective. Christ is the narrow path. It forces us
to experience God a certain way, which is a loving way, looking at God as a friend. That's what Christ has done for us. Now, I want you to look at this diagram of a telescope. We all know what this is. I remember as a kid, I wanted one of these. I got one. I stared out at the stars for a long time. It was never that powerful. But how does that really work? This is how it works. This is called a refracting telescope. This is how our sermon today. The Great Refractor. This is what I call the sermon. So light will hit the objective lens on the right. See the moon or the object. And it will go through that lens. And refracts. That lens changes the shape of the light and it narrows it down to a focal point. Where then on the other lens, the eyepiece, it now makes it perfectly clear for our eyes to see. Perfectly clear. This is kind of similar to what I was saying earlier, like what God does, what Christ does. Christ is this mechanism, this tool, this lens that will convert a God that's so big and so hard to understand and bring it into precision and make it so clear for us to understand and see. So let's consider then that God has asked us to look, to be seen as through a telescope, or through this lens that is Christ. Just as a Hubble telescope does focus our perspective to see the beauty of the galaxy, Christ is also the mechanism in which God has asked us to see Him. Christ becomes that focal point that we see right here, that makes all things clear. Christ is the perfect lens for the perfect time in history, so we can see the complete picture of God. Let's just bookend this once again with the scriptures in John 14, 6 and 7. Thomas says to Christ, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" And then verse 6, Jesus says, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." If you want to see the Father, you need to look through Christ.
Okay.
Right? If you really know me, you will know the Father as well. For Christ is transparent. If you look at Christ, you will see God. How God wants us to see Him. From now on, you don't know Him and have seen Him. Now, in conclusion, I want to share with you something that visually ties all this together for me in a very interesting way. There is, in South Africa, this sculpture of Nelson, dedicated to Nelson Mandela. Now, this is a little bit about it. It's in honor of Nelson Mandela on his 50th anniversary of his arrest by the apartheid police. Artist Marco Caffanelli was commissioned to produce the sculpture to stand in Howick, South Africa, on the exact unassuming spot that Nelson Mandela was at. Now, this installation consists of 50 steel columns which symbolize the prison bars that held him for 27 years. So, you know, let's just look at this for a moment. That's a very interesting sculpture. I love art. You know, I would love to go and see this. But you can meander around it and study all of these things. And if you get a little closer, you can see the detail. You can even appreciate the art, just for art's sake. You can see that detail on the left is intricate, very thought out, meticulous.
You see that man looking up and all like, wow, this is really amazing to see. But as you, the trick to this piece of art is that you don't approach it just any way. The artist has this in mind where you need to approach this art in one particular way. You can see the group of people funneling down into this very narrow path. And that's intentional. Christ does that for us. He narrows our focus. He brings us into this very important point in space and in time. There's this little dot down there. As you're approaching and you stand in that spot, right there, and we see, this is getting close to the focal point. Once you get to that focal point, boom, you see the image. You can only see it in one place at one time. Now you can appreciate the art from any angle. You can walk around it, but we try to approach God in every angle. We said, you know what? I'm going to put this Bible to the side. I'm going to approach God my way. And you know what? You might be happy because God is beautiful and He's amazing. You find God in a different approach, God will be with you. But God has something special. He says, I want you to see me how I want you to see me. He says, please come to Christ. Look at me through this very special moment in time and space, and you're going to see what I want you to see. So, as we stargaze and look into the heavens and see those tiny stars, and as beautiful as they are, remember, God has more for you. God wants us to see Him clearly focused in His full glory. The only way we can see God, how God wants us to see Him, is through Christ Jesus. Christ is the lens that reveals the true identity of God. We do not need to fabricate it, seek it elsewhere, read books upon it from philosophers and their opinions. Simply look into the sky and know in your heart there is more than you can see with your naked eye. Christ came to this earth just at the right moments in our history. He calibrated the lens so we do not need to see a blurry picture of God, but a beautiful, crisp image of God's love.
Amen.
Thank you. That brings to the end of the conversation. Please turn with me as we close with a hymn, number one, Praise to the Lord.
Thank you.
praise in and to ponder and contemplate these amazing things that you've given us here. Lord, I pray that you open our hearts and give us the clear vision of how that we see you how you want us to see you. Give each one of us a new perspective as we study and as we read and as we see, looking